Dear students, welcome to the knowledge series with the new segment on adaptive resonance theory. Adaptive resonance theory is one of the core area of the soft computing, and you all know that soft computing is the one of the current intelligent tools that is being used to design a systems that can able to operate in the absence of the human's interference. The term adaptive, it start giving an idea with respect to the adaptations. That means if a new system is incorporated to the prevailing systems, then the system should able to adapt to that particular change. And the resonance is nothing but the force that can be incorporated to that system so that there will be a change in that systems. So based on this adaptive resonance theory, we will see that why this particular adaptive resonance theory, or in short the ERT, plays a role in the soft computing. As the soft computing is a collection of a fuzzy logic, neural network, genetic algorithm, artificial intelligence, and so on. So let's see that particular this ERT, what role it plays in the soft computing. To understand this particular ERT systems, it is very important to understand the concept SPD. SPD stands for stability, plasticity, and a dilemma. Now this stability, plasticity, and dilemma, as the term, if you try to look across, it talks about a system behavior that does not change after irrelevant events. That means that if you give a input to a system, and after that you find that the new new input has come, then the previous input which was trained to that through that system will not get lost even if a new system a new input has come. After processing that input, if you again go back to the old input, the system should still produce the output. So then we can say that the system is stable. Otherwise, we will find that the system is not able to hold the information. Plasticity. Plasticity, as the if you look across this statement, it talks about the system adapt its behavior according to significant events. That means there is the in this particular plasticity, the model that you create based on the trained inputs, the model should be dynamic, that whenever the inputs is you are changing, or that the database is having a variations according to that one, the system should be able to recognize the change. So that's what he says, the system adapt its behavior according to the significant events. So the events, whatever it occurred, the system should accordingly change. So that is known as a plasticity, that is a dynamism. Now here what you see in the stability, that means you see that the system is stable, just like it is static in nature. That's what the dilemma is, nothing but the interference of stability and the plasticity together. So whenever interference of the plasticity and stability is existing, then the system should have to be trained. That means the system should be when I say a trained, means if the system is learning, and system should have a knowledge of the previous response, so that the current response, when switch back to the previous response, automatically the system should able to predict, and thereby the system should deliver the appropriate output. So the stability, plasticity and dilemma, if you want to understand that one, let me give a simple example. Is that, let us take that you are born and brought up in Thrissur, and after completing your graduation and you have moved to some other place for a job, and after spending say a few years, then you are returning back to your own land. At that time, when you reach, your mind starts looking the surrounding to see that what are the changes been occurred after you have left several years back. That means there is a two things you are seeing here. Whether you are able to recognize or recall the old event, that is first. And the second part is that whether you can integrate that old events and compare with the current changes. If you can perfectly do, then your system is very stable. That means your system can able to produce a better results. So this is the SPD in short what I mean to say. Now let us see the next part, the adaptive resonance theory. The adaptive resonance theory, this was developed by Stephen Grossberg and Gail Carpenter way back in 1987, after spending 20 years of their research in this particular network. And this is basically an unsupervised learning system or a technique. Unsupervised learning technique means where in the absence of any teacher or the or without having any presence of anybody's help, the systems can able to train themselves and can able to produce an output. Or I can say the systems in the case of unsupervised conditions, the system will able to produce the trained output based on the unlabeled data without anybody's guidance. The ART network implements a clustering algorithm. In this one, you will be seeing that it is going to implement a clustering algorithm. Input is present to the network and the algorithm is accordingly try to produce its output. To understand this adaptive resonance theory further, we are splitting further that particular terms like this: adaptive and resonance. Adaptive means open to new learning. Anything you want to learn, that one is termed as a adaptive. And resonance is that without losing old informations. That means if you are learning something by a certain force or by certain involvement, then you will be able to recall that one for a long period. So that's what we say, that without losing an old information is termed as a resonance, and learning a new thing is called as adaptive. Now this means exactly is that that in the neural network we use that particular intelligent tools to see that the network is trained every time you give an input, so that several iterations it will carry out to see that that input is being added with a certain amount of weight until you find that there is no further change in the output. Then we say that the network is trained or the network is learned. So in the neural network, without losing any information, if you try to learn, then we say that the system is a adaptive resonance theory. In a very small, I repeat again, a network without losing any old information with respect to the current information and try to learn. That means old has learned, and you are now learning new things, but by the time you learn new things, the old should not go from your mind. So that's what I mean to say. Then we term this system as a adaptive resonance theory, or ART. Now let's see this particular terms. This is an example where a neural network is shown. You don't worry about which type of a network is there. There are input layer is there, output layer is there, and two intermediate or a middle nodes is there, where a middle neural network is there. So this is a simple network. My concept is to talk about the previously used ART. Now let's take a case that in this network we are giving input A, and we are training this network to see that this network is learning this A, so to produce an output. You can equate this network just like a child, and you are mimicking that human brain. So when you give input A, the network will take its time to learn, and based on the learning capability, it will produce the output. Now after A, when the teacher, without the absence of a teacher, you are learning B, by that time you start spending your time to learn B. By that time you go back again to A, the network should immediately it should able to produce the output based on the concept of what I have told, based on the concept of SPD. If there are SPD conditions where your stability and plasticity, if it is sufficiently well defined, you will be producing A. Next time you will producing a B, again you go back, it will produce A. So this is what we mean with respect to the adaptive or ART, adaptive resonance network. Now let's see some of the things with respect to this figure. In a neural network, we can see that I have shown you some layer. Here there is a layer of input is there, and there is an output layer, input layer is there. There is another layer, another middle layer is there, and thirdly there is an output layer. Now here is nothing but a reset pins. So this input layer, that is the we put it as a F1A, and another layer is called as another F1B layer. So this is a input portions, this is the interface portions, and this is the output sections, or we can say that it's a F2 layer, that is a cluster unit. That means this particular layer has is going to contribute with respect to a principle. So there is a principle for this particular network layer is called as a comparison phase. Another is nothing but a recognition phase. This is nothing but your reset segments. So what is this comparisons phase and recognition phase, we will be seeing in the subsequent. But I just put this particular network in this section to make you to understand that this is the ART architectures and the basic steps to understand that what exactly the ART system is. Here you will be finding that some of the input, if you try to see this input, this is nothing but it goes something like a back propagations. So the network, the entire neural network training is based on the inputs, outputs, and if any error is there, based on that error the system is going to train. The reset pin is going to see that whether the input condition as well as the output condition, if it is not being matched, then it will keep on continuing that particular training until the desired output is coming with the number of epoch. So that is what this particular slide is being mean for. Now let us see this particular slide of the basic ART network architectures. Now in this ART network architectures, if you try to see this particular case, here is called as a comparison phase. That is what I was talking to you. There is a F1 is given here and F2 is being put across this one. These are nothing but a number of, let us take it to consider, these are nothing but a nodes, and these are nothing but a nodes of the recognitions field, and this is nothing but a comparison field. So you are giving an input, a normalized input. Based on this input, your output is being also generating. But there is a two thing is that your input and from this recognition phase field is again feeding back that input back to the comparison unit. And the comparison unit is being verified with respect to the vigilance parameters. And based on the vigilance parameter, the if the deviation is not up to the level of a vigilance parameter, then automatically the reset is being created. Then the reset of the recognitions field is being put under the further trained, and thereby again the layer input F1 is being compared. So this is what exactly take place in the case of a ART network architecture. Let's see this particular segment. Now, to understand this particular segment, let's see this particular area with respect to the operational principle. Now, in this case, the F2 layer, which is a recognition phase, and input is given to the comparison phase. Recognition phase means what is that? The input vector, in this case, the input vector is compared at every nodes and in the output layers. So this is what being seen, and that may, and in the comparison phase, what is that? The comparison of the input vector is being taken place over here. So under these conditions, the degree of the similarity is there, is being checked. So if you see this arrow, the input is coming, this layer is being processed that particular input, and it is given to the recognition phase. The recognition phase variations, if anything is changed, it is again backed to the input for the comparisons. If the output is not based on the input, automatically what will happen, the information goes to the reset pins, and again the particular search is continue. So that is what we see in this particular case. So the F1 layer accepts the input, performs some processing, then it transfer to the F2 layer, and it try to look for the best matching based on the classification factor. And there are weights are there. The different weights are used to controls the in such a way that there should be a degree of similarity between the output and the input, that is between the F1 and F2 layer. So F2 layer actually is a competitive layers. We can say it is a competitive because here is a comparisons. Now the cluster unit which is there across the output layer, it is going to take the input then this cluster unit will try to learn. That means this the candidate in the cluster unit is learning every time the input is coming, and it is going to produce the output. Output producing is that it is going to see that it is going to deliver what it has learned in the previous case, previous inputs weight. So if it is not okay, then again the weight is changed. So that's why the reset of the F2 pin is ignored based on the initial learning. But reset mean make a decisions whether or not this particular cluster is allowed to learn the input patterns or not. That means if this cluster is learning, then reset pin is not doing any resetting. Rather, but every time it is also checking this, this particular cluster is allowed to learn the input pattern or not. So we can say that it's a vigilance parameters that allows the new memories and the new information. So if this vigilance is more and more higher level, what it is going to see, it is going to produce a more detailed memories, and lower vigilance will what will happen, what it is going to do, it will be having a just lesser memories. So the vigilance parameters basically is going to see that whether this particular input, whatever it is learning at one instant, the next time when it is learning, whether the previous data, what is there in that particular system, whether that particular system can be able to recall or not. So that's why the system has to appropriately trained in such a way that the vigilance parameter can able to trace back these changes. Normally, this particular system is used in the ART1, that is asynchronous resonance theories 1. In a slow learning, when the weight change occurs very slowly during that trial, this in place of ART1, we are using this ART2 systems. Now, let's see this the figures with respect to the ART1. Now, if you try to see across this particular ART1 figures, as I told you, there are two phases, that one is the comparison phase, another is the recognition phase. Comparison phase is denoted by F1, and recognition phase is recognition phase is denoted by F2. And you have to understand one thing is that there is one more term, is that in the comparison phase, it is a short-term memory. That is a short-term memory. Whereas recognition phase is a long-term, as you know, as the name is, you can see. So if this short-term memory is only, its duty is that this input is, it talks about the input data, but it has nothing to do with the learning. Whereas this phase, the recognition phase, this phase is looking for a learning. So that's why it is a long-term memory layer it is being put across. Now, when we see across this particular case, in the case of a comparison logic, we are having several collections of the units like S1 to SM. And it is having also a X1, X2 up to XM. Now, if you look across in the figure F1A, it do not process the input pattern, but simply pass. That means whatever the input is coming, it is just passing that input to X1. On the interface pattern. So this is an interface. So it takes the input and take it to the X1, XI, XM. That's why I put it the entire things together. The input unit, interface is unit under the class of the comparisons. Now, this input is being processed to the F1B, and each time the unit of S changes, XI is also corresponding going to change. That means all SI is connected to the corresponding X of I. That means S1 to X1, S2 to X2, like that SN to XM. Now, the role of this interface is to broadcast the input pattern so that it can be recognized by the F2. So it is only broadcasting the input. Now, what F1B is going to do? F1B does the comparisons of the input weight patterns. This input weight pattern, with a one particular code, we term it as a winning code vector. With the help of a vigilance parameters. So actual comparison taking place here. So it will use that particular winning code vector, that is a part of the vigilance parameter, to see that these inputs and the from the output, these two things, whether it is able to recall or not. So you are training this one, but after learning, if again a new input is coming, whether it is able to recall or not. So that is the very important things particularly in the machine learning. When you are doing a training and testing of this particular large database codes. Now, coming to the further point of in this one is that if the weight pattern matches with the winning code, particularly if the weight you are doing in such a way the input is and there is a matching is there with the winning code vector, then we know that it is through the vigilance parameter, then the winning cluster will allow to learn a new things. That means every time you are these two, if the input weight pattern matches, that means here if the recognitions is checking this is equal to this, if this is matching, then what is going to happen? It is going to learn new things. That's what I given as an example of that you are going outside and after that you are coming back, but you are able to recall everything. That means your model is 100% efficient. So in that way, what you'll do, you can able to use the next time period for learning something new instead of spending the time on that particular to recall. So that's what I mean to say. If the weight pattern matches the winning code vector, what we term it as a vigilance parameter, which is checking this particular changes, then the cluster which is there in the output across this particular recognition phase, this recognition phase cluster will try to learn a new thing. Otherwise, what will happen? This reset pin, it will try to exhibit the cluster, then it will not able to learn the new things. It will try to recall the what is the old things. I repeat again, when the this cluster is active, when these two is are when the input and the trained output is matching, then that means the vigilance cluster vigilance is going to recognize that particular cluster, or a vigilance cluster vigilance is going to see that winning cluster is able to learn the trained in such a way that it can able to recognize the old event. If it is not so, then what will happen, and the reset is going to reset in such a way that the cluster will not take up a new job to learn. It will try to put for a train until the system is able to reach to a particular desired level. Now, if you look across the recognized layer, it is a competitive layers, particularly the competitive layers that has a distinct clusters. That has a distinct clusters. So ART1 provides the scope for comparisons of the number of a clusters unit with the F2 layer. So how many amount of clusters it is existing, that is being verified in the case of ART1. So now we will see further with respect to some of the content of this particular slide is that if all the cluster of Y1 to Yn is a distinct layer, and if the number is not, if a number is not fixed, ART will be having a capacity to what will, as ART1 will have a capacity to learn. Therefore, the vector will be update each time. And then the value will be almost all able to say that the particular F2 layer is able to produce results in such a way that the new cluster will be generating. So if it is not there, then what will happen? This F2 layer is not qualified to produce the output. And when the network is in the learning pattern, then F2 may be coming into any particular state. That state is what I will talk in the subsequent slides immediately after just mentioning some type of the ERT. There are few types of ERT. ERT1, which is the simplest and the basic ERT architecture that I was sharing, it is capable of clustering binary input values. So all the clustering is taking place with respect to input values. And ERT2 is extension of this ERT1, and this capable of a clustering continuous values of a input. It's a binary input, but it is a continuous value of input data. Fuzzy ERT, it is the augmentations of the fuzzy logic and ERT. So that is what a hybrid system is here. ERT map, it is a supervised form of ERT learning, where one ERT learn based on the previous ERT model. It is also known as a predictive model. This is particularly nowadays machine learning concept is being put across under this one, is that you train a model and the model will try to train another model. That's how it will keep on processing. That's why it's a supervisory form of a learning. FART map, this is a supervisory art architecture with a fuzzy logic included. So these are the different types of the ERT concept. Now another one, certain points with respect to the comparison layers, which I have just now stated, is being put across in this particular slide for the clear understanding. That is what I mean to say, that what is F1 layer, what is F2 layer, then what input layer F1 do not process the input pattern but simply pass, and what the F1 layer corresponding to the interface layer, and how the interface layer broadcast the input pattern to the F2 layer. Now in the recognition layer, which is nothing but the F2 layer, you can see that there are different states. The first state is active state, that is the unit is on, but the position it has a positive activation. Then in that case, this ERT1 activations in this case is 1. If it is the unit is on and this activations has a positive activations, then in that case ERT activation is 1. But if the if it is inactive, if the unit is off and activation is 0, you need to take part in the competitions. That is the second level. And it is inhibited, the unit is off, activation is 0, and no further participations of the competitions take place. So moreover, you will say that it is not allowed for the further participations for a competition during the learning process with the current input. If this inhibited conditions, it is prevailing. The particular things you have to understand, that in this particular recognition phase, the input and the output is been determined based on the weight factors. So the degree of the similarity in the case of from recognition layer to comparison layers, the degree of the similarity is less than the vigilance parameter. What it will do, then it will reset the cluster and it will not allow the cluster to go further. That means it will allow the cluster not to take a new job to learn, rather to go with the old. So that is what it talks about. And always there are one important things you have to remember, that there is a learning parameter, there is a vigilance parameters is being put across in either case. And apart from, there is a up vector and there is a down vector, the bottom up weight and top down weight. So this is also one of the important components for whenever you want to do this algorithm for analyzing a particular system. For any system, you have to apply this ART. Then you should have input, you should have a cluster weight, that is two things, plus you should have a bottom-up weight, top-down weight, then you should have a training parameter, then you have a learning parameters and vigilance parameter. These inputs, then only you can able to solve it. Now, what are the advantages? It is having several advantage and the disadvantage part. The advantage part of this one is that in the first case I am putting that it exhibits the stability and do not disturbed by wide variety of the input provided to its network. So stability of the system will be there because the cluster which is being formed, it is in a position to further go for learning a new. That means it can able to recognize the old inputs. And it can be integrated and used for the various other technique to give a good results. So because of this backpropagations, and the neural network could able to train in a learn by in adaptive manners. Competitive learning lacks the capability to add a new cluster when deemed necessary. That means in this competitive learning, if the competitive learning, its strength reduces based on the learning systems. That means based on the recognition system. So that's why the F2 is plays a very important components for the F1 to survive. So that's why competitive learning lacks the capability to add a new clusters when deemed necessary. So where the F2 plays a major roles. So what are the application of this ART coming? Mobile robot control, face recognition, land cover classification, target recognitions, medical diagnosis, signature verification, cluster web users. So such type of various areas which can able to contribute. Now it is also having a limitations. Limitation is that the ART network is having an inconsistency. The inconsistency in the ART network is basically depending upon the how the system is going to train, how the input that you feed to the systems, whether it is having any error in that one inputs, or the input variation is such that there is no condition to justify. If the condition is in such a way that the particular case with respect to the SPD. That means stability, plasticity, dilemma condition. If that particular condition does not meet, then and if it is deviating from plasticity and stability, then the new cluster formations will not take place. So these are some of the basic points related to the SPD, and. I believe that you have got an idea with respect to the adaptive resonance theory. In a one word, you have to understand that this adaptive recognition theory is basically resonance theory is basically one of the core area where we can able to do a wide area of the research, and it is a cognitive neural network theory. So that's why the more amount of reference you can able to refer through for getting a basic concept. With this, I conclude. Thank you.